Hello and welcome to this week's Practice as Research seminar. Today I have got a very, very special guest with me, Dr. Mhairi Thurston, who is going to be talking about practice as research in counselling. And she's particularly looking at the development of a model of counselling for sight loss. Now, Mhairi is an accredited and registered pluralistic counsellor, as well as a senior lecturer in counselling at Abertay University in Dundee. And she served on the British Association for Counselling and Psychotherapy Board of Governors from 2011 to 2020. And she chaired the research committee from 2018 to 2022. She currently chairs the British Association Counselling and Psychotherapy Good Practice Committee, and her primary research interest focuses on the social and emotional impact of acquired sight loss. She's interested in broader issues surrounding disability equality and inclusion, which is one of the reasons why I'm personally interested in her work as well. And she's also developed a pluralistic practice model for counselling individuals with vision impairment. Now, Mhairi has won the British Association of Counselling and Psychotherapy New Researcher Prize in 2019. She describes herself as an academic activist. And again, this is something that I'm particularly drawn to. So when Mhairi was talking about practice as research in counselling, I did recognise that and I did relate to that. But a lot of it was like, ooh, a fellow activist in academia. So that is something that's really important to me too. So Mhairi employs research and collaboration to effect real-world change for people with vision impairment. She has worked collaboratively with the RNIB to produce an award-winning training course for counsellors working with individuals who have a vision impairment. And she's also collaborated with Retina UK to create a free online resource that supports mental well-being in the visually impaired community. She founded the Sight Loss Research Network in collaboration with Dr. Hazel of McFarlane of Alliance Scotland, aiming to bring academics and charities together to foster opportunities for collaboration. She's previously been an associate editor for the International Journal of Disability Development and Education, and she's a member of the editorial board of Disability and Society. She also serves as a lay advisor for the Royal College of Ophthalmologists. And if I may add, Mhairi is severely sight impaired herself, and she has got a guide dog called Meadow. So I'm really, really excited. Thank you very, very much for your time and for being here and for sharing your expertise with us. I really, really appreciate that. And I really look forward to the discussion we're going to have about so many different things around practice as research. But without further ado, I'm going to stop sharing my screen and hand over to you, Mhairi.
Oh, wow. What that is very kind of you to, I got a mouthful in that introduction. I feel a bit embarrassed, really, like, God, I've been blowing my own trumpet there. Thank you. Thank you for that. And I'm so delighted to be here. I'm going to share my screen if I can.
Yes, please do.
And let's hope it will. Do I need to click any box to get sound on the I've got a sound snap on.
Yes, so if you click on the share screen at the bottom left, it does say share sound.
Share sound, that's what I was looking for. Wonderful, thank you. I'll share my desktop here. Hopefully that will work. Oh, share. Yeah. Zoom US. To share my computer audio, please install Zoom audio device and then restart my audio sharing application.
No, you shouldn't need to do that though. It should still work.
It should still work. I'll just press cancel, shall I? And we'll see. Oh dear, where are we now? So here we are.
I can see your screen now.
I can see my screen. How wonderful. Let me just put some of these away. And down here should be the presentation ready to go.
Perfect.
Fantastic. Right, we'll see how we go with this. I'm usually a Teams. So let's hope this goes okay. So I'm delighted to be here, as I said, talking about practices research in counselling and the journey to create a model of counselling for people with sight loss. So I'm going to talk about the mental health impacts of sight loss and bring in the voices of lived experience, and also then look at practices research in counselling. So there might be things about this presentation. So in the world of counselling and in counselling training, I'm really, we're kind of at home at looking at all kinds of difficult feelings and thoughts of suicide and depression and all these areas. So I'm kind of giving a warning for this talk that we'll be looking at some things that might be quite distressing in terms of mental health, but I've got some sources of support at the end of the presentation. If you've been affected in any way, then there's helplines that you can call, just to flag that up. Hopefully it won't be too, it's not over the top, but I just wanted to give a little a warning for that, because it's a different audience.
Thank you.
The association between sight loss and mental health is poor mental health is really well documented, and the most common impacts are around depression, anxiety, loneliness and social isolation, fear, hopelessness and suicidal thoughts. And recently in a review of the literature, I've seen that these things are not just UK-wide, they're kind of global, like they're global studies that have found that. So it's a universal kind of issues. So my own personal perspective of diagnosis was that I was 6 months pregnant with my third child, and I had two other children who were under three. I was working as a primary teacher full time, life was really busy. I was kind of juggling the kids and then being pregnant. And then I received this unexpected diagnosis of a sight condition called retinitis pigmentosa, which is degenerative, incurable, and it results in blindness. And there was no family history of this at all. And I remember at the time of receiving the diagnosis, I'd just been excused from class to go to the hospital to kind of talk to the consultant. And I came back to class straight after the appointment, and the headmistress said, "Oh, how did you get on at your appointment?" And I said, "Well, I think I've just been told I'm going blind." So, and I, at that point, I broke down, and she kind of whisked me away. And life was changed after that. So within the year after my diagnosis, there was a kind of decimation, right? So I'd stopped driving, I'd stopped working, I'd stopped functioning, I'd stopped mothering. I felt I was just, how could I be a mum? I kind of withdrew into myself. I lost earnings from my job as a teacher. I lost the house that we lived in because we weren't having the double income anymore. I lost my identity. I'd always been a teacher. Who was I now? I'd lost hope about the future, and I lost years to a deep depression, and nobody asked how I was feeling, right? So it was all the support that was existing was focused on function, about functionality. So it's like liquid level indicators, large print things, and mobility aids, right? So there was nothing about the feelings. So 4 years later, I got a guide dog, my first guide dog, called Wanda, and that's her in this picture there, my three children. At the time when we won, Wanda won the first guide dog of the year. In doing that, there was a whole load of publicity around us. We were on Blue Peter, and we were on the side of a double decker bus. And there was a kind of guide dog in-house publicity, magazines and all kinds of things. And my confidence returned, and I started a night class in counselling, and I went on. I just loved it, because I'd always thought, oh, teaching is my dream, but so I'd never considered counselling as completely something different to study. But I thought I could do that if I don't have sight. So I went on to complete an MSc in counselling and then a PhD, and I had a new career in academia, winning the prize from BACP for a study that was like a mixed method study, which was examining the emotional impact of sight loss. Because I thought, was it just me, right? Was it just me that felt that impact, or would other people feel the same? So I interviewed 18 participants with vision impairment about their experiences of sight loss and like in mood and self-concept and social connectedness and loss. And the key themes that emerged there were around receiving a diagnosis, how tricky that was, coping with degenerative sight, the challenges in that, the changing identity of the person, being treated differently by others when they experience rehabilitation, and experiencing multiple losses. Now, this is the bit that I'm not sure it will work, because I'd like to bring in here the voices of the participants who were talking about their experiences of loss, just because it highlights beautifully. So, right, this is going to be risky. I don't know. Maybe I should just read it out if I can. We'll see. What's it? Fingers crossed. I'll try this and see.
Yes, please.
There is a great loss.
Hear that?
And it's like a bereavement. You know, it'll never be there again. It's gone forever. You feel as though someone's chipped a bit out of your heart and your soul. You think something's gone and you'll never see it again. It's like when you lose someone close to you because you're losing a sense. You go through the anger. You go through the bitterness, and then you come out of that, and you grieve over what you're losing. I was grieving, but I kept it into myself. As your sight gets worse, you're losing all the time because you're losing your independence, and you've got to have help, which makes you lose your pride, and that takes down your self-esteem. I think driving is still the biggest loss, you know. The independence of driving, the freedom to say, oh, well, let's just go off to the lakes or the highlands for the weekend. You know, you've lost that. You don't have the freedom to jump in the car and drive somewhere. So often you're waiting for somebody to come and give you a lift somewhere. You do spend time sitting there. Not being able to read to the grandchildren is a huge loss. I just can't do the things I used to. That's it. Every day is the same. I'm bored. I would like to be able to work in a charity shop, but I can't because I can't see the money. I was intending to go away to work in Asia first and then on to New Zealand. I was going to take my partner and my kid over, but that got hit on the head. I used to go to football and all that, but I can't go there. You do think from time to time, oh yes, this would have been a lovely day, or I could just be cantering up here, you know, a nice grassy path. I used to love going to see the opera, but I didn't go this year because I can't see a damn thing. It's not the same when you can't see it, so what's the point? You don't see your grandchildren or places you visit. It makes you depressed if you think about it. You lose everything in a oneer. It's just life itself is loss. To know what the heck to do, you know, you get bored stiff in your own four walls. You say to yourself, what can I do? And you look at yourself and you say, sit there and shut up because you can't do anything. You know, it's frustrating. With disabilities, people say they'll get a few quid in benefits, but I mean, it's nothing to what you've lost.
Wow. So there let me move on. So I think they just expressed that so powerfully, and I was just struck by, I mean, that was just lifted verbatim from transcripts, but it felt like it really communicated something important about the impact of sight loss. So I thought, well, can counselling help? Could counselling help this? Like, because I was trained as a counsellor by then. And I had gone to counselling myself just after I'd got my guide dog, Wanda. But the counsellor didn't seem to understand the issues that I was facing with sight loss. And I couldn't really articulate them properly. And I ended up feeling like I'd failed at counselling. So when I kind of trained to become a counsellor, I thought, well, Could I counsel clients with sight loss and see if I could understand the process? And maybe I could use counselling practice as research. And from that, perhaps I could build a practice model based on multiple cases. So this is kind of really using this practice as a form of research. So we had the learning from the legal system here, because in the legal system, cases are a source of knowledge and precedent, right? And there's a process of interrogation of the evidence from two contrasting perspectives. So from the prosecution and the defence. And then the judge arrives at a final reasoned conclusion. And we thought, well, actually, that this type of model from the legal system has the potential to improve the rigor of case studies in counselling. So I used a method called hermeneutic single case efficacy design. I don't know if this is a kind of commonly known type of research method, but in terms of getting it prepared and preparing to do the study, we got ethical approval and consents from the university. And as part of the study, the client is offered six sessions of counselling from myself as the counsellor. And each session is recorded and transcribed. So we have like that amalgamates like 6 hour sessions of transcripts, which so it's quite a sizable amount of transcripts. And there's pre and post outcome and process measures that are collected after and before and after every session. And then 6 weeks after the therapy, there is an interview to assess change, which follows a particular format. And then from all these sources of data, like all the outcome measures, the process measures and everything, plus the transcripts, forms this kind of book of evidence, right? And that's it's a huge thing called a rich case record. So the evidence, in terms of analysing the evidence is presented in the style of like a mock courtroom. So the affirmative case, so people who are analysing it for an affirmative to say that the counselling was worked, they present first, and then the sceptics present their evidence that it wasn't the counselling, it was something else. And then there's rebuttals, and then there's an independent judge that arrives at the final reasoned conclusion. So Sylvia was the first case. I want to talk about her. She was really important. She was a 71-year-old female who was a retired occupational therapist, and she lived alone in a rural location in Scotland. And she had a problem with her carotid artery and went for an operation to stabilise her vision. And she says, "I woke up the next day with no sight." So she had a fortnightly rotation of live-in carers, and she had 6 sessions of counselling as a research client. So before her sight loss, she described herself as quite a bubbly person. She had a strong faith. She had went to church. She had home groups. She went to Bible studies, and she enjoyed walking and travelling and art and socialising and visiting the lonely, as she called it. But after her sight loss, she said, "I feel my life has been taken away from me. I'm in the world, but I'm not really there. There doesn't seem to be a future for me, really, no purpose. I do quite wish I was dead. I mean, I don't have plans to end my life, but that's my weekly wish." So things were feeling really bleak for Sylvia. So her goal for counselling was to accept my blindness and to be more positive. And we had the problem rating scale. So this was like a scale out of 0 and 9 about how much this had been bothering her. And she rated it couldn't be worse. It was bothering her as a 9. And how important this was to her life as a whole, she rated that as a 9. And how much progress she expected to make in counselling, she rated that as 3. She hadn't really much hope for counselling. And I remember as her counsellor thinking, actually, this is a really tall order. This has been such a traumatic event, but we'll see how we go, because kind of that sense, we'll just try it and see. So after every session, Sylvia filled in a form which was about what she found helpful in therapy, her helpful aspects of therapy. So these are some of the things that she identified, that it was about sharing The way that she felt with somebody who listens made her feel more relaxed, and that she was able to talk about my situation now without holding back, being honest about my feelings of frustration, having someone who believed in me, it encouraged me to go on. Comparing the old me and the new me, unraveling my thoughts and feelings about being a burden and needing a lot of help, talking about ways of coping when I feel suffocated, and reflecting on how I relate to various carers and the effect this has on me. So these are the things that she found were helpful out of the six sessions. So at the end of counselling, one of the standard measures we use in counselling is a core 34 form. I don't know, maybe you've heard of this, maybe you haven't, but it's like a form that was just a kind of general measure of the person's well-being and how they are, like their mental health generally. So from the start of it, she had all her problems, all the aspects of this, so that the well-being, her view of the problem, her functioning, her risk levels, they were all above average, right? But at the end of the six sessions, they had dropped. So they dropped from 72 as a kind of, so the higher the score, basically, the more distress the client is in. So it dropped from 72 to 58, which was generally lower, but it was still at clinical levels. And we also used a hope state scale, which initially she was at 11. It was very low, indicating a kind of low hope. But the final, after the 6 weeks, it had increased, but generally it was still low. It was like 18 out of 48, so it was still low, but had shown improvement. And then the change interview. So this is done by an independent person who tries to help the client identify what has changed for them. This is done 6 weeks after the counselling ends. And they really kind of interrogate to say, could it be anything else? So they try not to say, right, so what did counselling help you do? It's more done as a, has anything changed? What do you think that is? So she said that she was feeling less lonely, that she was feeling more hopeful, and that she had an incentive to find groups. And she said, and we quantify, like, was that change expected? And she said she was surprised by it on all counts, that without therapy, it was unlikely, and that the importance of it was important to her life. So how we analysed all this data then is we had 20 student volunteers at a research day. We had two groups that were analysing the data from an affirmative position, and three groups analysing the data from the sceptic position, and four independent adjudicators to review the evidence that the students presented and to deliver a judgment. And one of these was a social scientist who wasn't a counsellor, so that we could get some kind of a kind of perspective that wasn't an in perspective. It was a sort of a more dispassionate perspective. And the brief that they had was, for the affirmative groups, what evidence supports the view that it's a good outcome case and that the outcome can be directly attributed to counselling? And the sceptic groups had to say, what evidence supports the view it's not a good outcome case, or that the positive outcomes can be explained by non-psychotherapy factors? And both were asked to think about, was the therapist's experience of sight loss relevant to the outcome? Because I think a part of me was like, well, does it need to be somebody who's experienced sight loss? Like, what difference does that make? Because the counsellor I went to didn't have experience of sight loss. And I thought, was it an important factor that your counsellor needs to have experienced this? So the case for the affirmatives, they said that there was an improvement in the outcome and the process data scores, that there was positive client testimony, that the counselling had helped her find a purpose, that counselling had become a lifeline, and that the change summary results showed that the change was unlikely without therapy, and that the client had developed new ways of looking at the problem, and that the counsellor's own experience of blindness allowed the client to feel understood. So the case for the sceptics, so they were ones looking at, like, was it something else? So they said, well, there was only minimal variation in the core scores, that the positive process outcomes were a desire to please the counsellor, and that the client needed a purpose in life, and it was the taking part in the research that gave a purpose, not the counselling. that her course score had kind of improved after session five when she got new carer, and it was the carer that had the positive impact, not the counselling, and that the counsellor as a person with sight impairment helped rather than the counselling process. It was about just having a kind of somebody else experience it. So the two different versions of analysis were presented to the four judges to see what they would come up with, right? So Judge one said it was a limited success verdict that that more than six sessions were needed. Judge two said it was a good outcome verdict that the counsellor's expertise and shared experience of sight loss was significant. Judge three thought it was a successful outcome verdict and that the counsellor being blind was helpful. And the independent judge thought it was a successful outcome verdict because of the evidence in the client testimony. So to afford kind of similar-ish adjudications. So the first steps to making this towards a practice model from this case, we learned is that six sessions is too limited, that the and we identified things that the client and therapist might do together in therapy, and I call them therapeutic tasks. This is a kind of pluralistic approach to looking at counselling. So the things that the counsellor could do in therapy with the client together is expressing difficult emotions, perhaps like fear or despair or loss of hope, talking about multiple losses, the independence, identity, the notion of an old life, exploring identity, like the old and the new, who am I now that I can't see, challenging negative self-concepts about being a burden and being useless, and identifying coping strategies and cultural resources. So what happened next is that more cases were analysed until we had a kind of saturation of data. So I counselled more clients, and we also collected helpful aspects of therapy from other clients who were being counselled in the research centre. And we used, we didn't use the quasi-judicial on all of the cases, we used them on two of the cases, and we used the ward method. It's another method of analysis, which is a creative consensus method, which is for another day. The model of counselling for clients with sight loss was developed based on what the clients found helpful in therapy. So we're kind of really confident this is coming. It's a kind of client-led model of counselling. So after that, I collaborated with RNIB to produce this free training course for qualified counsellors to use this model, because what we kind of were thinking is that actually these are really complex, complex aspects to psychological aspects of having, of acquiring sight loss. And actually you might, your counsellor might not go to these places unless they understand what's going on for the client, and then they kind of are tentative about broaching these things with the client. So this training course trains up these skills, these counsellors, to work with them, and it gives them an opportunity to become an accredited counsellor as a visibly better counsellor badged by RNIB. And it has just been piloted in NHS England talking therapies. So a wee postscript to this, 1 year on, Sylvia's course scores were all non-clinical. She'd completely come down in all of these. Her carers took her to visit the lonely, so she kind of found that aspect back of her life. She held her first dinner party since losing her sight, and she continued to describe counselling as her lifeline. So that is where we've got to so far. I've put there a list of if you've been affected by the presentation in any way, there are some helpful contact details there, just on the off chance so that you're not alone. Thank you.
Thank you very, very much, Mhairi. This is really, really exciting. And I love it how you've got this postscript of Silver a year on. That's really, 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 really nice to hear, that she has found sort of a way back into life again. You know, I imagine that must have been really hard for her. So it's lovely to hear that story. Thank you very much. Also, you know, thank you for the presentation generally. Obviously, I'm going to ask you a load of questions now. Could you stop sharing your screen, please?
Yes, so I did.
A little bit better. Thank you. Perfect. So I guess the first question I'm going to ask is, do you think, I mean, I know that you've developed this training specifically for counselling and you know, in relation to visual impairment, but do you think that your model would actually work for other kinds of disabilities as well, where people may acquire disabilities later in life and may also have exactly those same experiences, that feeling of loss and of grieving their previous selves and losing their identity because they're no longer, you know, quite as able and capable of doing the things that they wanted to do? Do you think that model can be adapted?
Oh, wow. That's a beautiful question. I've really never thought about that, but you're right. There are some similarities. You're saying that's a no-brainer, but actually, I haven't really thought about that because I always thought, oh, if you're doing a model of clients and for clients, it needs to be kind of led by the clients that are, like, you know, experiencing that. But I certainly think the methodology for I would love somebody to pick this up as a research and to do this type of research, counselling research with different client groups. And certainly it's been done for clients with depression, and there's one coming out, there's one in the lovely Charlotte Scott doing her PhD around counselling for people with learning disabilities, that like to understand what they need. So I've always thought it was a bit like bespoke to each client group, but actually I could see that there might be helpful things for people who acquire a disability, because there's something about leaving the kind of able-bodied world and entering this new world, which is a really difficult identity transition. And there's all kinds of things about internalized stigma and you know, the existential aspects of the limitations of bodily.
Yes. Yeah, I mean, it's interesting because obviously my work is within that field, where I'm looking at the lived experience of disabled, chronically ill and neurodivergent academics. And a lot of these people that I've been talking to have got acquired conditions, or, you know, where perhaps they've had some underlying issues even from early on in their lives. But as they get progressively worse, they lose aspects of their mobility, or they lose aspects of their independence. So even if something's been there all along, it's not necessarily stable. So that kind of experience of the grieving of the before and the after and the making sense of it is something that all of those people are talking about. And the other thing I would suggest is that a lot of people, you know, I always say that a lot of people struggle to reach out for help, because you've got to, the first step is that you've got to admit to yourself that you need help, that you can't get over this by yourself. So I could totally see this model work for so many other kind of groups of people.
Yeah, I love what you're talking about. There is absolutely this similar to sight loss, because it's that degenerative part of it. Like, you can't get away from it, like, because you're looking out of your eyes and they're worse, you know, they're getting worse. And the limitations that are the increasing limitations on life. So, yeah, that coping with any degenerative condition is really tough. Yeah, I'm so glad you're researching this area. I'm so glad.
Yeah, right, exactly. One of the other questions I've got around your definition, if I may. Obviously, practice as research is something that's difficult to define, and it's difficult in different kinds of disciplinary conventions. And the practice as research network connects a lot of people from different disciplines. It'd be nice if you could perhaps say a little bit about how you define practice as research and how that is different from just research or just practice.
Yeah, that's really good. I think it's tricky to do that. You're right. I mean, certainly in counselling, if we're trying to work with clients, then we have to understand what the process is. We have to be kind of doing the process in order to understand it better. And that's very different from, I mean, I think you can still do counselling research by, you know, like desk-based, you know, looking at literature and searching literature. But there's something about the actual practice, looking at the practice, researching the practice, where the practice is essential to the research. Yeah, that, I think I'm not very good at describing that, but that sort of thing. It's intrinsic.
It's good to hear that, though, because a lot of, you know, this is the thing with practice as research, a lot of practitioners do it, but they're not necessarily able to describe it, or they're not necessarily getting the validation, I suppose, within academia, because it's not conventional, it's kind of different. Within the creative industries and within the creative fields, it's almost easier, because if the painter paints, then you know, as in, you know, doing practice as research, and the painter paints, by the end of it, the outcome is that painting, and you can hold that in your hand and you can show it to people, and you've got something tangible. But what's the outcome of practice as research in the kind of work that you do?
Yeah, so I think the outcome is, it's an understanding that is generated by practice. Often we call it practitioner research, which may be slightly different as practice as research, but that's what we would say. It's like these practitioners who are researching their practice, the practice of counselling, you know, say for in our instance, and there's that sense of like, there doesn't, even in the terms of the like inviting the client to talk about helpful aspects of therapy or to understand what the client is is feeling post or pre or post, you know, and the different things about it, the qualities of it, is, I think that sort of feeds back into the counselling profession, so that there's kind of a knowledge awareness of actually what is happening in practice.
I like that description of yours, that it kind of feeds back into it. It's almost like something that you're not stepping out of that. You kind of continue constantly going forward and moving on and deepening your understanding. I really like that.
Yeah, I was really liking how you resonated with the academic activism aspect of this. And I think this is kind of related. It's about, you know, for me, it was about not just being in like in desk based. It was about, you know, like certainly with my work with blind, partially sighted people, it was felt really important to understand what the policies were that were affecting them, and to be part of their networks, and to, you know, to have that really acceptance of myself as part of that community, that kind of insider perspective. So it felt like I don't want to just research for the sake of research. It's purposeful. It's to make a difference in the world. It's to make life better for like people who were affected by sight loss, as in some way almost like righting the wrongs that I experienced myself. Like, you know, so I love that there's a resonance there for you.
Yes. Around activist work again, I mean, this is for me, this is, you know, my practice as research work is very much around that I do things like you. I do things, and in the doing I get new understanding and new knowledge, and with that new knowledge I then try to create something that will change, you know, the world, even if it's just a tiny eeny weeny bit, but it's making a difference for someone somewhere. So I totally link the practice, the research, the teaching, and the activist work, and all of that kind of goes together. I can't separate the one from the other. It's constantly feeding into each other, and they're constantly interrelated. At the same time, I find that working in that space is very tiring.
Yeah.
Do you find that too?
Yeah. It's exhausting. Yes, because it means so much that you can't stop. That's what I find. It's like it's got so much meaning that it's difficult to step back from it and go, all right, I'm going to put this down for a couple of weeks. I'm going to go to the Bahamas or wherever. It's like, no, because I got, you know, this invite here could lead to something here that could, it's just, it's hard. It's exhausting. It's very personal, I think, you know.
Yeah. Yes, I agree with that. The personal emotional investment that you put into it, and the fact that, like you say, you know, when you're tired, it feels like you want to have a break for a few weeks at least, if not for a few months. And then at the same time, I feel guilty about taking that break, you know, thinking, actually, no, there is so much more work that needs to be done. I can't be if I'm one of the few people doing that work and I'm stepping out of it and everybody else is stepping out of it because they're tired, then what happens? So yes, that guilt keeps me driving on and pushing on when actually I'm kind of feeling, you know what, I really can't be doing with this anymore. I am knackered. Yeah, I totally get that. The other question, if I may ask, about that poem that you shared with us, which was lovely, by the way. It's really, really impactful. And I love hearing your voicing that poem. It was really, really lovely. But at the same time, I'm interested in that because the Practice as Research Network has got a subgroup that is dealing with fiction writing. As a practice as research, and another group dealing with poetic inquiry, so writing poetry as practice as research. So how did you come to create that poem? Was that something that felt like, you know, you had to do, that was more of an internal compulsion and part of the activist work, or did somebody suggest to you, you know, how did you come to produce that?
That's a really great question. Well, I've always been interested in narrative research. Like, I think, you know, and the gift of people and autoethnographies and all of that stuff. And when I was doing, like, I'm not skilled in that at all, but when I was analysing the data for that, I was kind of looking at the testimonies of people around that area. When I just thought, out of interest, I'm going to take them out and see what that looks like, or, you know, extract the theme of loss. And when I saw it there, I thought, that is so poetic. That is actually so powerfully poetic that I thought, I need to make that, I need to do something with it. And it sat there for, I mean, that was 2009, and we're now in 2024. It sat in my files for so long, and I thought, I need to bring this out because it's so powerful. And I, because I thought, right, so there's never a buzz about sight loss, right? You know how there's sometimes a buzz about things that you get, there's never a buzz. And I thought, well, how do I engage people in the area of sight loss, what it's like to have sight loss, because it's so hidden, you know, and it's so feared, and it's like it's a real subculture that is seen as, like, you know, for older people or for like a niche. But I thought people would relate to that feelings of loss. That makes almost feel like I want it to be a hook, but it is entirely an unprofessional eye over just a kind of sense of, I feel that's really powerful. But you're the first people to hear it, right? It's not been
lovely. Well, this makes more special now. Oh, I'm excited.
So I'm so glad it's had some impact. Other people may hear it now.
Absolutely. And yes, definitely. So I may share a link with you where there is an option of uploading poetry to BBC website. So maybe I'll share that link with you separately.
thank you.
Well, thank you very, very much, Mhairi, for your time. I really, really appreciate that. I'm quite conscious of the time, so I want to make sure that we wrap up well in ahead of the end of the hour. So I'm just going to very quickly share my screen to offer people an opportunity to, you know, sort of reconnect with the Practice as Research Network. Here are the links for the PAR YouTube channel or the audio hosted on the PAR Breastbelt. Or the Practice as Research website. So, you know, please do connect with me as well. And there's nicole.brown@ucl.ac.uk. Again, Mhairi, thank you very, very much for your time and for the presentation. It was lovely. And I hope that the two of us are going to have some more conversations in the future, because I can see a lot of things coming out of that where there is potential to collaborate as well.
Yeah, I'm excited that Nicole, I really thank you for this opportunity and for the work that you're doing. It's just wonderful to be asked. So thank you so much.